So this is part four in the series on Lifespan, the new book by David Sinclair. I'm having a blast on it because he covers items that I've done videos on. This one I'm very passionate about, metformin and anti-aging. This is the Tang Study. This is near Barzilai. TAME stands for Targeting Aging with Metformin. Dr. Barzilai is the principal investigator, but as I've said many times, there were dozens of gerontologists, people that study aging, involved in development of this study. Now, why would we want to use metformin for anti-aging? What they're looking for is a composite outcome, things like decreased eye disease, decreased kidney disease, decreased cancer, decreased heart disease, decreased stroke, decreased cognitive decline. So hopefully that begins to make the point. Why metformin? Metformin is the most widely prescribed anti-diabetic medication in the world, and it decreases hepatic gluconeogenesis. However, as David Sinclair would say, it also upregulates or amps up AMPK. Now, why is AMPK an issue, and why is David Sinclair focusing on it? Well, this is an overview of all of the places in the metabolism where metformin impacts different places that drive aging, like TNF, tissue necrosis factor, TNF-alpha, IGF, insulin-like growth factor, insulin and its receptor, AMPK, as David Sinclair mentions in his book, mTOR, as I think is mentioned in the book, and we've mentioned multiple other places as well. These are all, and SIRT1, David Sinclair discovered the SIRT enzymes, which again are very involved in driving the epigenetics and the metabolism associated with insulin resistance and broader aging components. So this is just another quick look from a recent article in the New England Journal. It mentions AMPK and insulin-like growth factor. This article, you may recognize, is on autophagy. So again, hopefully helping connect quite a few dots here. Again, why metformin? As I've said before, it's been used safely for over 60 years. It's associated with decreased cancer, decreased cognitive decline, and all those other diseases that we mentioned. How did they develop a composite outcome? Again, they wanted things that were age-related, common in populations, and created a significant health risk. Again, I'm not going to repeat the different items that were included. When you look at three of the key diseases that we're talking about, and I've already mentioned them, they're already associated with decreased problems when you're taking metformin. Here's an example, observational studies, metformin and cardiovascular outcomes. We saw that in the MACE study, the VA Medicare database, Canadian study, REACH study, the VA patients study, cancer. As you see on this, I think this is called a Christmas tree plot. Multiple studies out there showing that people that were on metformin were on this left side of this vertical line. What does that mean? That means they were less likely to get cancer. How about cognitive decline? Again, multiple studies. Ng with the Singapore Longitudinal Aging Study, Ching with the Taiwan database, Su with health insurance in Taiwan, several others, again, decreased dementia associated with use of metformin. All-cause mortality. In other words, you remember we've talked about this before in other studies. Something may have a huge positive impact on cardiovascular disease, but since even though heart attacks and strokes are only, they're the number one and what, number three cause of death, they still only cause about a third of deaths overall. So you'd have to have a huge impact for something that decreases heart attack and stroke and also decreases total mortality. That's exactly what you see with metformin. Again, underlining the strength of the association with anti-aging and positive impacts using this medication. There's other components. I've already mentioned these before. This is repetitive. The Tang Study design, they're looking at 850 milligrams two times a day, and it's a double-blind randomized placebo-controlled trial. So you can't get any better in terms of the type of study. Now, what's the inclusion criteria? Unfortunately, they're looking at people 65 to 79. I think they're waiting too late. David Sinclair, for example, started taking metformin in his late 40s. I started taking it in my mid-50s, late 50s. Where's the Tang Study now? Well, this is like the third or fourth video overall out of over 600 that I've done on Tang. So, again, I've done three or four. If you don't remember them, don't worry about it. We've covered most of the materials here. Here's the problem. I don't think it's completely funded yet. This is a Forbes article on the Tang Study from February of this year. In our first videos 2 years ago, we talked about how it wasn't being funded yet, and how the NIH was fighting it because it's against aging. And they can't fund something that's against aging. They can only fund countermeasures against disease. So, kind of weird, huh? But Barzilai was fighting the good fight. Now, about a year ago, we heard that it got funded. Still haven't heard the results, though, and this may be why. If you look at the rest of this Forbes article from February, AMFAR, the American Federation for Aging Research, has committed $35 million to it. They're hoping for another $40 million from NIH. However, NIH is still dragging its feet because it's not a disease. It's anti-aging. The obvious question comes up, why don't they just label it against one of these diseases? I'm not there. I'm not involved in that battle. Anyhow, one other thing that we can say is that the big pharma are not involved in funding this. Heck, why would they? I mean, who's going to make any money off metformin? Doesn't make sense to them. But it does make sense to me, and it's unfortunate that so few people have investigated this more deeply. This was a long video. I appreciate your interest, especially if you've made it this far.
So I'm very excited to announce we now have a membership page. Now, what is that? That's the one place where you can go and access all of our digital products. It starts off with a few free things, like a lot of infographics, which help you understand the basics of insulin resistance, cardiovascular inflammation, and other key concepts on how to prevent heart attack and stroke. The next free item is the intro and first chapter of the book that we're writing on plaque. And the standards of medicine just aren't doing very well right now in terms of the number one killer and disabler, plaque. We don't do a good job of measuring it. We don't do a good job of monitoring it. And there are better ways. So that's what this book is all about. Again, go in and get a look at the intro and the first chapter. And if you've purchased the cardiovascular inflammation and IR courses, thank you so much for doing that. You purchased those at a time before we had them totally cleaned up, and we've cleaned them up now. And they're available for you right there on the membership page. Hit the link below, register, and go in and take a look. Look forward to seeing you there. Thank you.